Today we're talking about the two gun control measures that the House just passed, the Bipartisan Background Checks Act of 2019 and the Enhanced Background Checks Act of 2019. Guess they couldn't get bipartisan support for that second one. Elephant in the room, I know what some first-time watchers are probably thinking. Oh, a YouTuber's doing a video about gun control, and there's no camo anywhere on his set? Well, this is about to be condescending. At least try to disguise your lamp as a shrub or something. And I realize I've chosen a particularly divisive topic today, but my goal is just to explain these two bills, maybe have a few laughs along the way, and figure out whether you like this or not. So let's get started with the Bipartisan Background Checks Act of 2019. The purpose of this act is to utilize the current background checks process in the United States to ensure that individuals prohibited from gun possession are not allowed to obtain firearms. Now, that may sound great, but as Texas representative and man who Saturday Night Live ruined making fun of, Dan Crenshaw, points out,
what universal background checks actually mean. What they don't mean is this. They don't mean background checks at a gun dealer. That already happens. That's already absolutely required, and we all agree with that. What they do mean is that you can no longer transfer a gun to a friend. You can no longer let your girlfriend or boyfriend use your weapon if you leave and they're at home trying to defend themselves. They would be made a felon if they use that weapon.
So, okay, now we see the tightrope that this bill has to toe. If I'm in a house and there's a gun there and someone's breaking in, I'm not gonna start thinking, boy, I really wish I had a license for this thing. No, I'm grabbing the thing and then getting seriously injured because I have no idea what I'm doing. I did shoot rifles and shotguns as a Boy Scout, and I'll just keep lying to myself and saying that's adequate training. This bill actually tries to address this concern in a way that to many might actually seem a little too lenient. I read this section and it's long, boring, and whoever wrote it definitely had a thesaurus on hand, so I'm gonna summarize this next portion. If you're not a licensed seller of guns, you can't transfer a gun to a person who is not licensed. Except if it's a gift between domestic partners, parents and children, including step-parents and their step-kids, siblings, aunts or uncles and their nieces or nephews, and you bet your cool uncle has a gun or two he'd like to give you, or grandparents and their grandchildren. Now you might hear that and think, but what if my friend has a cool gun and I want to use it while not going through all the work to get a gun license? Well, never fear, because transfers can happen at a shooting gallery. But shooting galleries are so lame. I want to kill. In that case, for the purposes of hunting, trapping, or fishing, you can do this as well. Although, if you're using your rifle to go fishing, I hope you packed a dinner ahead of time. That is, unless those fish are in a barrel. Apparently, it's easier to shoot them then.
Fish in a barrel!
But let's just say there's an open carry rally, and you don't have a license for a gun, but you still want to go and look like you're one of the guys. Are you not going to be included? Well, anytime you're in the presence of the transferer, you're good to go. Lastly, let's go back to our dreaded house invasion. If someone's in my house and I don't have a license to use a gun, can I use it in self-defense? Yes. Feel free to pause and read all that, but in cases of imminent death, great bodily harm, domestic violence, dating partner violence, sexual assault, stalking, and domestic abuse, these transfer restrictions do not apply. So Crenshaw, sounds like literally every one of your concerns have been addressed. So that's good. Now to the liberal concerns, because with all those exceptions, what does this thing even do? Well, if you overlook all of those exceptions, this bill makes it so that if you want to buy a gun, you need a background check conducted by a licensed firearm seller, as opposed to
private dealers are not legally required to conduct background checks.
I would ask you for a Virginia driver's license. That way I know you're from within the state.
But if I gave you a fake Virginia driver's license, you would never.
I would have no idea.
Would you trust me? Do I have an honest face? Would you sell it to me?
I'd trust you. You'd give an honest face
okay.
to me. I
mean. But that being said, sometimes if you don't think someone has an honest face, if you have a bad vibe, you don't sell it.
Correct.
If you're a private seller, regulations on you vary state by state, including gunshot loopholes and the ability to just buy a gun off of a website like armsless.com in some states. It's like Craigslist, except less sketchy. This would make it federal law that anyone selling someone else a gun would have to run a basic background check before the sale, rather than a check of, he's giving me a good vibe. One other controversial thing this bill does is just a little thing Republicans slipped in that has Democrats split, requiring gun sellers notify Immigration and Customs Enforcement when an illegal immigrant tries to buy a gun. To most of you, that might seem fine or a good idea, but others, led by Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez, want to get rid of this amendment because they want to make sure that ICE has as little power as possible. Which definitely sounds like the way someone slandering Hiro would explain the argument, but yeah, that's really just what the argument is. So okay, that's the Bipartisan Background Checks Act of 2019. Now it's time to get into something more controversial.
I'm proud to co-sponsor the Enhanced Background Checks Act, H.R. 1112.
Just to really rub your nose in it for the half of you that have this video open on another tab but are only half paying attention, we're leaving the Bipartisan Background Checks Act of 2019 that says background checks on all sales of weapons need to happen. And now we're entering the Enhanced Background Checks of 2019 portion of the video. That says, yeah, and on top of universal background checks, those background checks need to be more thorough. Currently, if a background check takes more than 3 business days, we got tired of looking them up online, just sell them the gun. The main thing this bill would do was to expand that period to 10 days, with an additional 10 days if they're on the fence as to whether you're gonna start killing people as soon as they sell you a gun. This isn't to say that the average background check will now take 10 days, as for my research, it seems like most background checks are finished long before that 3-day period. But if you have some holes in your data, the government has to fill that stuff in, and that takes time. Apparently, Big Brother needs to clean the room once in a while. Advocates say,
James Comey saying that shooter Dylan Roof should not have been able to buy the gun he used to shoot and kill 9 people at a black church in South Carolina, according to authorities.
Yes, because of the need to expedite the gun buying process, the FBI had to overlook a key point in a felony drug charge that would have made this shooter ineligible for gun ownership, because they couldn't find the police report in the 3-day period. The other thing this act does is work with the Government Accountability Office to see if taking those extra 7 days is actually helping to identify more people with traits that would make them ineligible for gun ownership, or whether this is all just a waste of time. These reports would come out 1 year, 3 years, and 5 years after this act is implemented. And oh man, me and all my other primary source junkies out there are gonna have a field day with those reports. So that's what these 2 gun control bills that just passed the House say. Some of you might be surprised to hear these are being called the first major gun control laws in decades. Which, I guess they're major. The next step will be pretty hard for these bills though, because
Donald Trump, who at one point said he was in favor of tougher gun laws, says he will veto anything that makes owning a gun harder.
And the Senate seems pretty divided along party lines as well on this problem. So these 2 bills are definitely facing an uphill battle. But the one thing I think they have working for them is that the support for universal background checks seems to fall somewhere between 94 and 88%. In 2015, when they polled NRA members, that number did fall to 74%, but that's the National Rifle Association. Now the polls aren't always right, especially when, New York Times readers overwhelmingly support background checks, you don't say. But the aggregation of all these polls does paint a picture of an overwhelmingly popular policy that's separating representatives a lot more than the people they're representing. Until next time, thank you, and that's all I have to say about that. Hello YouTube, I hope you enjoyed this video. If you want to support independent, nonpartisan news, remember to subscribe by clicking on this floating logo to the right of my head. Ring that bell so that freedom will continue to ring, and give me a thumbs up if you like what you saw. Lastly, as always, thank you for watching.